table a while ago. I said, where'd you live when you were a kid? He said, lived in Riverdale. I said, Riverdale? Whoa. Very expensive place. And I said, you right by the Hudson River? And well, not that close, but we were there. And then he starts talking. He says there was a rehab place there. And a lot of famous people. Peter Lorre came there, like a drunk tank, you know. And some other famous lady, I'm ashamed, I can't remember. And it mentioned all kinds of people went there. It's a famous place to go if you're, you know, like today, they still do it. You know, you read about Britney Spears or somebody, you know. That's what it was.
Yes.
And he said, I said, oh, you still there? No, no, no. He says, my mother, I was a kid. He says, my mother said we had to move. There was a, found a dead body in his backyard.
Oh, my gosh. Oh. That's a wonderful
New Jersey. And the people behind his house found a dead body in their backyard.
Oh, boy.
Oh,
what a life.
Gosh.
I wish I had something exciting like that to talk to. right next to him was a guy named Tom Weaver that some of you know, who writes for all the magazines. Tom Weaver. And I said, are you listening to this? He says, oh, yeah. He says, I wrote about all that stuff. Well, I said, you just like confirm everything you wrote.
Wow.
He said he was right there. Imagine finding a dead body in your backyard.
No, not really.
In a classy neighborhood.
Yes.
Anyway, you all of you, I don't know, I'm looking at you, you're old enough to remember, and I don't want to pick out anybody and say, oh, you're old enough to remember the TV shows, which started back in, it was 50 years ago,
yes.
This fall, when
it?
Frankenstein and Dracula movies were released for television.
It was?
50 years ago today. This next fall, yeah. So we're going to celebrate that. That's a little scary. I can't believe that 50 years have gone by. A lot of things I didn't do and I should have done, I didn't do. But that happened to everybody, I guess. A lot of places I never got to that I should have done. So I sit at home, watch travel pictures.
That's good.
Some of the travel pictures are neat. I mean, really, people climbing up the Great Wall of China and all that stuff.
Right.
I never had any idea of going there, but boy, when you think back in the years, way before horror movies, and you figure, what did those Chinese people do to make people build that wall? And they cracked the stones by hand, you know? I don't know, they must have had some kind of devil to do it, and built this tremendous wall up and down the mountains. Unbelievable, and it's still standing. And they say you can see that from space.
Really?
On the face, you see the Earth and all the continents, and you can see the wall of China.
Oh my gosh.
But I mean, they must have killed a lot of people right on the
shore.
Out in the wilderness, you know, in the mountains. You could never go home at night or see movies or anything like that.
Right.
Emperors were where they were. But yes, hello?
Just a question. You must have done a lot of traveling for yourself, though. You must have done a lot of traveling for yourself, though. What was your favorite place that you've been to?
My favorite place for what?
That you've been to.
Favorite place you've ever been.
Oh, well, I do. I've been to the Caribbean a little bit, twice, I think. The islands are really amazing. What I miss when not seeing is that clear blue water. Boy, that's amazing when you see that. Oh, and in the army, I went from Philadelphia to Carlisle, Pennsylvania, then to Louisiana. And then we took a whole bunch of soldiers. It was a segregated army, and I was in a black battalion. It was a very amazing experience. All these young kids were about my age. I was a lieutenant, really stupid lieutenant. I was supposed to be in the infantry, but I never got to the infantry. When I joined up, they took everybody, came out of ROTC. They still had that, I think, around. And we went out to get the camps ready for all the guys who were being drafted. And so I was there, and then I was sent down to Louisiana, where they had the big camps. Getting ready, all empty, all these brand new buildings and these wooden barracks. And we were supposed to supply the troops. They came in, and all of a sudden, one day, there was about six of us officers for this battalion, and steam train came into this area and a whole bunch of guys came out with big puzzles on their back, you know, barracks full of things from the uniforms they were in. All from Brooklyn. A whole bunch of guys from Brooklyn. Jeez, you know? Hey man, where are you from? I'm from Brooklyn. It was terrific. And I was with them for about a year, and then the rules were if you were drafted for a year before the war started, and a year is up, you go home. So a lot of them went home, packed up and went home, and I guess I'm surely they went back in again. So I'm trying to be talking about things I saw. So eventually that company was supposed to go to Panama to help protect the Panama Canal and then after the war started. But they weren't in, this was a supply company, it wasn't a fighting company. It was so funny, the rules they had of the peacetime army was that if you were sent overseas, you had to have a real examination, physical examination. Did x-rays, check your eyes, all this stuff. Later on, they didn't bother with that, you know. If you couldn't see that, they might give you a pair of glasses. So I didn't go to Panama because they saw spots on my lung. And they put two and two together and decided that I had spots on my lung. We had some regular army guys who were supposed to help us train these men. And one of them had a history of tuberculosis. Is that what it would be?
Uh-huh.
Yes, that's what it was. And I thought, wow. So they sent me to a hospital in New Orleans. And I was there for a couple of weeks and taking x-rays. And they said, you don't have that, you had pneumonia. Oh. I thought I was going to go to Denver and live in a high altitude place for tuberculosis people and never see the war. So I'm talking about places I've seen. So eventually I did go overseas, but with that was also an all-black regiment. We went to Scotland and England. Then we went to Africa after they invaded Africa. So I saw Africa, and then I left that group and went to Sicily. The war was ahead of us. We were not in the war. No. We had two airplanes come over one night and drop some bombs on the port where we were working, but nothing happened. That's not true. No, that's not true at all. Because my lieutenant of my company was on duty that night. He was wounded from a bomb, and he was taken to the hospital in town, and they operated on him, and they used a sodium pentothal, I think was the new thing, and they think he died from that. They operated on him and he died. But that's as close as we got. We could see the air raid from way out in the country where we were camped. It's like 4th of July, you know, we're so far away. But we see all these tracer bullets coming up and all. Then we went to Sicily. I saw some of Palermo. It's a great tour I'm going through here.
Yeah.
And I didn't see any horror movies over there. I did
no.
see, when I got to Africa, I saw General Patton, we all remember him from the movie. We all went to church on the, must have been Christmas Eve or something. And all of a sudden, down the aisle comes General Patton with his boots on, you know, and his aides went down and sat in the very front row of the church. That was exciting. He had lost his command because he slapped the guy. Remember that story? He was in a hospital one day checking out wounded men. And there was one guy sitting there like this, you know, and he claimed, Patton said, he's a coward, get out of here, go ahead. The guy was a nervous wreck for some action he'd been through. So he was relieved of his command. So what we saw that night in the church was all he had. He didn't have any army. But then General Eisenhower realized that he was a great general. So he had him transferred to England, and he was in on the invasion and all that, and became a big hero in winning the war. So I saw Sicily and Italy. Never saw any real action. But you could see the destruction that had happened and see those old cities. So that was a kind of a tour. And I still got a friend who was a lieutenant myself over in Italy. Came from Philadelphia, and we never knew each other until the war. And he's down in Philadelphia now, in worse shape every day. So that's the last person I've seen. Anyway, that's what I've seen. I went to Paris after the war when I was on the radio at EWFM.
Yeah.
I took a trip to, didn't know anybody over there. But I went over to see England. That's interesting. Well, when I was over there during the war, I got an order to go down to London, a truck from Liverpool where we were, and we were supposed to bring some supplies back or something. So we drove down in these big army trucks and landed in London in the dark. And I thought, I better go see these old friends of my family, and I remember them too. One summer we lived out in the country in Philadelphia, and there were two people there from England, a man and his wife, and he was losing his eyesight because he'd been a watchmaker or something, and he was doing this all the time. And I don't remember as a kid why they chose to come to America to rest his eyes, I don't know. But they were nice people. So I thought I'd look them up, and it's just a big blackout was on them. And I pulled up right near where I heard address and all that. I guess I must have stopped at the firehouse and asked them where it was. And the guys who drove me down there, they stayed with the firemen and I went off to see these people. And they were really glad to see me. I had probably been in touch with them with Christmas cards and stuff like that. Because they were really my parents' friends. And the interesting thing they had, that they were old folks then. And I heard there was an air raid and they were some around them. Bombs coming down. They had a table this high. It was a field of armor plate here. It was really heavy steel, and heavy steel legs, and underneath was a low platform, and on the sides were big heavy screens you could lift up and drop down. It was an air raid. You were an old post, and instead of going down to an air raid shelter, you got under there and hoped that nothing hit you, but if it did, in a falling building, you might be protected. Now, that was my introduction to what life was like for them anyway. But it's a scary business, and we saw a lot of devastation in Liverpool where the parts of the town were just blown apart. But no air raids. By then Hitler had stopped, they were losing too many airplanes or something, and he stopped bombing. But that got me to England, and I went back afterwards, I can say, when I was on the radio. Really enjoyed that. It was great. I went to Paris once, a few years after that. Lady I knew there was remodeling a house on the called a barn. She and her husband. Then they got mad at each other and divorced.
Oh.
And so she took me out and showed me this incredible barn that they were turning into a house. But what happened to me then? I had a kidney stone.
Ooh, I say that.
That was the end of that tour. But it was fun to see these faraway places. So if you haven't done it, you should do it.
Mm-hmm. When did
recently,
you start?
A man called in touch with me who used to live in New York City. And he was about 50 years old, and he was out in Oregon. And he came to the city, he called me on the phone, he said, coming in to see my sister out in Patchogue. And I'll stop by and see you. So we spent the whole day, a really nice guy. And his job out there was work for the state police, chasing lumber trucks that he thought were overloaded, trying to save the highways. He'd stop the truck, and they have a portable weighing machine that they back wheels up over, and they'd say, overloaded, and find the company. That's what he did. But unfortunately for him, maybe a year, 2 years after I left him, he was told that he had, they knew he had Hodgkin's disease, but they gave him something to keep it in check. But they all of a sudden said, well, the medicine's not working anymore, we can't do anything for you. And he's got about 6 months to live, and he stretched it out to 7. But he sent me such beautiful pictures of Oregon. I never thought of going to Oregon. Just a gorgeous place.
Really?
Crater Lake, you know, left over from volcanic times. And somebody here was talking to last night, said, been there? Oh, he said, yeah, it's very steep. And it's full of was just almost pure water. He said if you step, like you're going to go swimming, if you step that far, you're liable to be 100 feet underground. It's that steep.
Wow.
Canyon full of water. The what do you call it? The volcano was the old age. But beautiful country. He also saw on the radio, his son sent me a copy of his radio show. Mm-hmm. The same kind of music that I used to play in New York. WNEWFM. So what's new with you folks? You braved the weather? How far did you come from? Anybody just local, most of you? Yeah?
Poughkeepsie.
Poughkeepsie, sure. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Boston.
Poughkeepsie's downtown is still going through hard times, right?
Oh, it is. Yes. Terrible.
For a long time it's been that way.
Boy, you know that. Yeah.
But they got that great restaurant.
Yes, down
you
by
go
the
above
river.
Poughkeepsie and find your way down to the water.
Yeah.
There's a restaurant right on the water.
Oh, there is.
Yes.
Yeah, and you can see the bridge up here.
Yeah.
It's a railroad bridge there, too.
Yes.
And
good memory.
You're sitting there eating all this stuff right behind you.
Drink.
Express train goes by.
Yeah.
Whoa!
Now they've added colored lights to the bridge. So
they changed
from, say, 4th of July, they put red and white bulbs.
That's a walking bridge now, isn't it?
You can walk on the side
of
it, but there's the other railroad bridge that burnt down.
That's
and
the only
that, they're trying to make that a walkway, a walk bridge.
Yeah.
Where are you from originally?
A place called Germantown, Philadelphia.
Oh, okay. I don't know it.
Settled by Francis Daniel Pastorius.
Oh.
He brought a bunch of German pioneers, I guess they thought they were, to this country, I guess, before the Revolution.
Mm.
And they settled in, that's why it's called Germantown. His house was right across the street from my high school, Germantown High School.
Oh.
Still there. The neighborhood's hanging on. There's a bunch of, Philadelphia has a lot of revolutionary history and houses. And the Germantown Pike, as it was called, is just lying there, running along, trying to save. Most of them are under the care of the Star of the Society.
Oh, that's good.
That was great. But as far as horror movies are concerned, I never saw a horror movie when I was a kid. I'd tell this story over and over again. Wasn't allowed to see them. Suddenly here I'm on the television introducing our movies.
Business. How'd you get to do that then? What made you?
Well, I that's an old story. I did the first thing I ever did on television was a cowboy show. A live cowboy show, no tape. So it was every day in the afternoon, I guess it was called Action in the Afternoon. Action in the Afternoon. Hubbardly, Montana in 1882, something like that it's supposed to be. So we're riding horses, shooting guns, and running indoors and outdoors, because without taping it's live, you know.
Yes.
You come riding in and get your horse up in front of what looks like the bar or the outside of the false front buildings. You say, I'm going to have a drink. Go in and disappear and run around and go indoors where the bar room was. That kind of crazy.
Yeah.
And one day I played an undertaker.
Oh.
So 2 years later, a suit just like this, which I stole from a little theater group. I like to think they gave it to me. I never took it back. This is the third one. And they called me up and said, I'm going to be a host of this show. And I had no idea what they're talking about. Never, my parents said, no, you can't go to those movies. Some little pamphlet came every month about what movies were suitable for children.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess I was during the 30s when all those movies were created, and I must have been 12 or 13 years old when I could go see them. So I spent the weekends home on those occasions. I went to the movies, all right, but I didn't see any scary movies. So I ended up doing it. I didn't know. And I must say that they didn't give me any instructions. I didn't know how to act. You know, I'd come down and start talking. Well, here we are. And I don't know where I cut that from. Nobody said do that.
Yeah, it was great.
The only instruction we had was from the boss one time after he saw us on the air. used to watch the movies so he could make comments about the movies.
Right.
When they broke it up ahead of time into segments so that they could put commercials in there and I'd be there on the side of the commercial. So I guess the first week or so after we did it, I would come down the spiral staircase, big studio, very high. And there was a catwalk all the way around and a spiral stairway in the corner, and that's where my place was. And I'd come down there, you know, with this basket, this wicker basket.
Yeah.
Not this big, you know.
Yeah.
And there's chocolate syrup dripping out of it. And it was like somebody's head in there, you know.
Yeah.
And his comment was, if there's a head in there, God damn it, I want to see it. He wanted us to be more scary, but we were just having fun more.
Yeah.
And I think all the hosts around the country were having fun.
Yeah.
And then eventually we started jumping in and out of the movies.
That was fun.
That's how that began. So I saw all the films. People ask me, do you watch them anymore? I said, no, I saw them about six times.
Yeah.
I said, no, occasionally, though, I see, I have a small collection. Occasionally, you don't see them much anymore. They're only on the Sci-Fi Channel. Where do they show the old black and white?
Oh, there's a Turner Classic
movies.
Turner Classic. Yeah, well, they're really fun to see, and they were really, really great. You know, and they left a lot to your imagination.
Yes, that was a good part.
Yeah.
Didn't have to show all the gore.
Yeah.
But you were great peeking in through those bushes and feeding the head of cabbage, wasn't it?
Yes, sure.
Yeah.
Well, that was exciting to do because when I got to New York, it still hadn't no tape machine, so it was all done. The film was running, couldn't stop the film, and it was a place for me to jump in and say something or peek out of the bushes as part of the scene.
Great.
We had to do it. The film was always running. We just switched from the camera to see the camera to the back to the film.
Yeah.
And sometimes we wouldn't quite make it or whatever.
Right.
But it was fun to do.
Oh, yeah.
We did more and more of it. But then tape came in and they told us. The other exciting thing was it was late at night. I first came to New York on Channel 7 after the news. Tom and Abidori normally be ready to go to bed, but or all the other guys who worked there. But when tape came in, they said, look, we got tape now, we can't afford to keep the engineers here late at night anymore. So you've got an hour and a half, do an hour and a half show on Thursday afternoon. That's a funny feeling, because you used to think that, not consciously, you were aware that it was live and it was going out. Watching at that minute.
Yeah.
And once they started doing it on tape, you realized nobody was watching but the cameraman and the guys in the control room.
Yeah.
Strangely. And then the people who have been in television longer than I had and were used to live television for years, they all have funny stories about the mistakes that were made and they had to keep on going.
Yeah.
The bloopers and things that happened.
Right.
But I had enough experience in live TV, including the Cowboy Show, to remember how exciting it was. There was a time on the Cowboy Show when we did rehearse it on that show, and after we rehearsed it, the director would come down and he'd change everything. And then I think we have a final rehearsal that go right on the air. And somewhere there one day, we're shooting off guns and all the horses ran away.
Wow.
The horses we got from a riding stable out of the studio in Philadelphia. And they all ran away. And the cops had to go out and find them, and they found them on people's lawns.
Did they?
And one horse was famous because he would, during the week, they would hire him out for riding. Sundays. I guess, Saturday and Sundays. Yeah, we did the show during the week, so Saturday and Sundays, they were back at the stable being rented up. He would always throw people off and he'd come and hide out in the old set behind the studio instead of going back to the stable.
Oh,
he became famous for that.
Wow.
Well, it was a great show. But anyway, we had a lot of fun there starting off all this stuff with the movies. particularly because we had such a big studio. When I came to New York, the studio was only this high, and the lighting man could almost reach up and reach the lights without finding a ladder. But it pulled up, it's very high. I remember once we had a rocket, we built a rocket. It was about 6 feet tall and still on the tail down on the next to it. And a still picture, we have that. And we put a CO2 bottle on the bottom, you know, and opened up some shh. And then lifted it up.
Yeah.
Great, it went out of sight, you know, really.
Yeah.
Wow. We drove a car in one time from one of those cut-ins into the movie. Big door in the back, you could drive in and out.
Really?
A lot of people started there. Ed McMahon started there.
Really?
And who else was famous up here in New York? There's a guy named Cunningham, who used to be the film critic on Channel 7. Dennis Cunningham.
Oh, okay.
Of course, Dick Clark started to live too. That was fun. He had a dancing show, as you know, in Philadelphia where Bandstand started. And I guess after I did the first few months of the horror movies in Philadelphia, record company called me up and asked me to come down and make a movie. I used to help them the show with limericks that people sent me. And I read these limericks, you know, and this guy's sitting home watching with his daughter. Got the idea of, oh, we're going to make a 45.
You did the monster.
A novelty record. So he called me and we made Dinner with Drag.
Oh, Dinner with Drag.
And the guy who said, there's a head in that basket, I want to see it. He didn't like that I did that.
Oh.
So he took me off the air for a week as punishment.
Really?
I wasn't really signed up at all.
Uh-huh.
And on the record it says John Zacherle. It doesn't say Roland, which is the name of the character I played.
Oh.
So he had to back away on. I never really had much to say and talk to him about, I recall, personally. We must have had a meeting or something once in a while. But the thing caught on amazingly. You know? College kids, high school kids, junior high school kids, maybe even younger. Everybody, every one of you has stories about how you used to, you know, parents wouldn't let you watch. The guy yesterday was telling me about his parents would sit down there watching, and then we would come to the head of the stairway and peek through the banister. Get back in bed.
Yeah.
Or people would wait until their parents went to bed and then come down.
Yeah.
But it was an exciting time, a lot of fun too. It kind of deteriorated when I went to different stations.
Yeah.
Because Channel 11, I forget how that happened. There were three stations in New York that were doing children's shows, Soupy Sales and Captain Kangaroo, all that stuff. Well, that was a morning show. Didn't you have the same idea? I don't know if he was playing that early. Chuck McCann, all those people. Captain Jack, Officer Joe, all that stuff. And I did that for a little bit. It was kind of difficult to do because Three Stooges, and I'm talking to little young kids. So I had to come up with crazy experiments. I remember one time I bought an old electric train set that was still in our house. So we set it up on the floor, and somebody had sent me a big spider made of VX cable legs, you know, and the body up here. So I said, well, that'll make a great tunnel. So we had the train go underneath the spider and all this stuff. And when it snowed, I would get buckets of snow off the windowsill of the Daily News building. I made a snowman on the ground, flat, you know, and it melted all over the place, which irritated the guys who had to clean it up. But eventually he put me on the movies late at night. They didn't have any great movies. The best movies were on Channel 7, the Universal horror film. They had some good movies, Mighty Joe Young, but they wouldn't let me play around at King Kong. That was their prize film. So. Show that as $1 million movie.
Yeah, $1 million.
Let me mess with that. But they gave me Mighty Joe Young. We had a lot of fun with that. They had detective movies too, I think. What's her name? Edna May Oliver and Jimmy Gleason. She was a detective. She was a female detective. It was very hard to have fun with those films because there was nothing scary to it. At any rate, here we are. And I don't know how many years ago it was. How long has this been going on? 14 years or so? killer. But anyway, Kevin called me up, and we started over at the William Carlos Williams Museum over in Rutherford. And I had no idea what to expect. My God, I mean, people showed up because nowadays, I'm not saying you're getting old, but in those days, a whole lot of people showed up to see this character. And mostly now that the age group is much spread around. They have a show here called Led East every Labor Day weekend. It's fantastic. Everything about the 50s. People come who belong to 50s automobile clubs. They come with pristine automobiles that like they came from the showroom. They come with, they've all been customized and crazy looking cars. They park all the way around this hotel with their backs to the wall, and then they leave a space and they have other cars facing them. It's a room in the middle to drive around. They do that at nighttime. Everybody has a tent to sit and drink and beer and doing a barbecue. And they have music from the 50s, and I was one time television from the 50s, you know. And everybody is was the right age. I could walk down the hallway and everybody's, hey, exactly, everybody without telling. But now we have much younger people that lose that kind. But it's been a great experience. I appreciate your coming.
Oh, we appreciate seeing you.
Thank you.